6 o'clock.
We'll hit it.
All right. One, let's call this meeting to order. And then is there a motion to go into closed session?
Motion.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shack.
Aye.
Mr. Moss.
Aye.
Ms. Biggs.
Aye.
Mr. Creed.
Aye.
Mr. King.
Aye.
Chair Tuck.
Aye.
6 ayes.
Be it resolved, the Board of Supervisors hereby enters into the closed meeting for the purpose of discussing the following. Discussion or consideration of the acquisition of real property for public purpose or the disposition of publicly held property or publicly held real property where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of the public body. One, the former Blacksburg High School property. Two, the former AEP property. Three, State Street property. Next is discussion, consideration, or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, performance, demotion, salaries, disciplinary, or resignation of specific officers, appointees, or employees of any public body. One, library board. Two, social services board. Is there a motion to come out of closed meeting?
So moved.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Moss.
Aye.
Ms. Biggs.
Aye.
Mr. Creed.
Aye.
Ms. Progress.
Aye.
Mr. King.
Aye.
Mr. Shepard.
Aye.
Chair Tuck.
Aye.
7 ayes.
Whereas the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas under Section 2.2-3711 of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by the Board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County, Virginia, hereby certifies to the best of each member's knowledge only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification resolution applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion conveying the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered by the board. And this is our word to you that we're not talking about things in closed session that we're not supposed to be.
Right.
Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Biggs.
Aye.
Mr. Creed.
Aye.
Ms. Progress.
Aye.
Mr. King.
Aye.
Mr. Shepard.
Aye.
Mr. Moss.
Aye.
Chair Tuck.
Aye.
7 ayes.
At this time, we're going to observe a moment of silence, and then I'm going to ask the County Administrator to lead us in the pledge.
Let us pledge, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much.
We initially had on our agenda that Lieutenant Colonel Alicia Masson, excuse me, would be presenting for the Bradford Army Ammunitions Plant. However, there was an employee who had a health emergency, and she is at UVA with her employee, and so she's going to try to reschedule at a later date. And so with that being said, Mr. Turner.
Given notice by the county attorney, I've had 2 minutes, and the video is a little bit longer than that.
We'll give you three.
We have the distinct pleasure of having kicked off our Citizens Alert program. After a lot of research, we selected a company called Everbridge, and pretty much Everbridge is the company, and that's the last that you need to know about that. We call it Citizens Alert, Montgomery County Citizens Alert. Why is it important? So we wanted to show a video that I think best describes why we're confident that this is the right thing to do at the right time. So if you will perform me the pleasure, we'll. I am not left-handed.
Our world moves at a very fast pace now. We can't always guess what's around the next corner, but it's always better to be more prepared than not be prepared at all.
In the event of an emergency or severe weather, you want to be informed and know what to do to keep you and your family safe. The best way to do this is by signing up for Montgomery County Citizens Alert, the county's emergency notification system. Signing up is simple. Just head to our website and look for the links to Citizens Alert. Once you're in the system, customize it to your individual needs.
It enables us to contact those citizens who are interested in knowing more about their community and more about emergency response. As they sign up, they would be able to select a menu of the items that they would like to be notified for, whether it be hazardous weather, flooding events, boil water notices through the health department, or pandemics through the health department, things of that nature. And by them signing up, actually doing their own, picking their own menu, they're much more capable of narrowing down the alerts that they get.
Provide the information you want to provide and select the types of alerts you want to receive and how you want to receive them. Text, phone call, email. It's that easy. And in the end, by signing up for Citizens Alert, you help us help you in more ways than one.
So instead of worrying about maybe calling 25 people or 100 people or even a greater number, I make one call, we activate the system, everybody gets the exact same message with the exact same tone of the message at one time. Then we're moving on to the next phase of whether it be a rescue, a preparedness, or a response to something actively going on.
Well, not only will it let the citizens know of anything coming up that they might need to know about in order to prepare, but it will save a lot of time for us. It will save a lot of incoming phone traffic, email traffic, text traffic for us that we can devote to other areas where our resources should be moving out to in order to try to keep up with the flow of whatever situation is occurring.
Sign up for Citizens Alert at montva.com.
So as you can see, the biggest key to the Citizens Alert program is to try to develop a sense of preparedness for the citizens so that we know in emergency management that the greatest outcomes in disaster come from those folks who are better prepared before the disaster. It gives us an opportunity to reduce the damage to property, most importantly to life. That's our greatest concern. How well we pre-plan for an event is often the difference between success and failure. And having a plan and practicing that plan is paramount to the outcome. So as we move forward, the Citizens Alert sends a message through a primary contact path, whether that be your cell phone, your home phone, if you still have one. And the reason that we say that, a lot of folks have gone away from the landline. So cell phone, home phone, your desktop computer, your work phone. So you may live in another county or another area and work in Montgomery County, you can have that alert. And that allows you the opportunity to gather the information exactly where you are at the time the alert might go out. As you saw in the video, some severe weather issues, this will give us an opportunity to alert you to weather that's coming our way. One of the automatic features of this alert system is the weather component, the severe weather component. If you've already signed up for it, and I hope you have, this weekend you've got about three alerts that told you about lightning in the area. Three were a little bit excessive, so we've modified that a little bit. You won't get so many. Someone asked me today, or told me today, that they got three alerts about lightning. One was enough, and I said, well, our opinion is we'd rather you be well notified than not notified at all. So those are some of the things that we'll work out. It's also used to inform residents and businesses of events that are going on, whether they be critical incidents or whether they will in the future be just announcements. The system contacts thousands of people in a moment's notice. Now, when we initially thought about this, we said that everybody gets the message immediately. That would depend on where you're at. If you've got good cell service and you get it on your cell phone, you're going to get it as soon as we press the button. If you've got poor cell service, of course, that's going to be the delay. But recipients receive the exact same message. So all of us in this room tonight, when we get that message, it's exactly the same tone. It's exactly the same message all the way. Home phone, cell phone, business phone, email, hearing impaired. We have the proper procedures to go through to do that. Text messages. There's many opportunities that we have to send these notices out. And they might include evacuations. Thank goodness we don't do a lot of evacuations in our county, but we have in the past and could possibly in the future. Flooding, the announcement of a flood, that it's pending and it's coming down. Lockdowns. We've had numerous lockdowns in the last few years. Missing persons. This will automatically, in cooperation with FEMA through the iPulse network, we have integrated this system with the Amber Alerts and the Silver Alerts. So as they automatically go out, you automatically get another notice through our system. Just another opportunity. Power outages. We can notify you that power is out in such and such area. The roads are closed. Severe weather, utility failures of other means. And then in the future, the Citizens Alert will be able to tell you things. For example, even Parks and Rec could use it to notify parents that a ball game has been canceled or due to weather or whatever the case might be. The success of this service depends on the subscriber. If we have interest, which we already have about 700 people who have signed up, and we're excited about that, that's a week's work. So, you know, realizing that people are excited to know what's going on is a huge help. Now, for example, if you signed up and you changed numbers, very simple. You go back in, access your profile, change your information, and that's no problem whatsoever. So how do you sign up? Go to www.montva.com/citizenalert. You go in, and I will tell you that it's very simple. You may get to a point where you say, well, I'm not sure what to do. Pick the phone up and call us. We'd love to walk you through it. And if you say, well, I'm just not comfortable, as a lady called the other day, she said, I'm not comfortable doing it. I talked her through it, took her information, and did it for her. And it takes about 2 minutes to sign up. Once you're in, you're in. And then all of a sudden you say, well, you know, I really don't want that. They're calling me every time it lightens. Just stop that. This was our subscribership as of May 20th. That sort of gives you a broad brush of where our citizens have signed up. the two largest groups, Blacksburg and Christiansburg, and then throughout the county. And we're excited to know that people are interested in it. It's something, it's not a new system by any means. Everbridge, particularly, is a system used by the state of Virginia for Virginia Department of Emergency Management. You access the system, edit your profile, edit your subscriptions. For example, if you had signed up to notices about Parks and Rec and you no longer have children that are involved, you go in and opt out of it. It's very simple. If you're getting an alert that you don't want, then opt out of it. Also, it has a quiet segment in there that you can go in and choose. If you go to bed at 9 and get up at 6, you can go in and tell it, don't give me an alert between 9 and 6. Now, my concern with that is we want you to be notified about an emergency, whether it's between 9 p.m. and 6 a.m. anyway. So we encourage you not to select that, but you can if you feel like you're getting too many of the alerts. Anytime that you would want to, anytime, you can opt out of the system, and you just simply do that by deleting your selections. Special thanks to the Newburgh Valley Health District. They were able to secure a grant and pay for the first year of this program. They're very much a partner with this, and will use it for such things as boil water notices, Zika virus education. Right now, they're going to push alerts to the citizens about that. The public information staff, Josh, Durley, and Ruth, have been phenomenal to help get this kicked off. To Everbridge, those folks are exceptional to work with. They've given us a lot of support. VDM and FEMA, and we couldn't do some of the things that we're doing without the partnership with them. So that's sort of it in a nutshell. I'm a little over, Mr. Attorney, but
I'll
answer any questions that you might have.
There, Supervisor Shepherd.
I don't have any questions. Thank
Supervisor DeMonts.
Just a couple for you.
Okay.
First, I noticed that the information about Citizens Alert went out with the tax tickets. What other marketing avenues are you using to make sure people are aware, like water bills, or I know it's on the website.
On the website, word of mouth is probably our best method. Notices like playing before meeting here on the television station and things of that nature. And also, hopefully the media will pick up and give us what we need.
Hopefully the media will pick up.
I wrote a story 2 weeks ago.
And we appreciate it.
And then you talked a little bit about future uses. Would that be something that the Board of Supervisors could use in the future if citizens opted in to receive our agendas in advance? Would that be a service that it could be used for?
I don't see why it couldn't be used for anything that we do, really. One of the reasons that we chose Everbridge is because their company offered so many extra, we sort of, in the beginning of it, called it favors to the program. It's not just emergency alerts. It can be used for many things. And like I mentioned with Parks and Rec, if each child that signed up, the parents signed up for this alert, then when they had bad weather or maybe they got bumped off of the field for whatever the reason might be, they could get that notice. There'll be no ball game at such and such park.
That's it. Test over.
Supervisor Biggs.
Well, I'm really excited we finally have this.
Me too.
I mean, this is a long time coming. And I had a couple things. Well, of course, I'm going to ask you, once we get the animal care and adoption center up, if it could be used to notify people of any information they might need for that. And I guess it can because of what you said. Another way you might advertise is through our public libraries and maybe possibly the schools and get people signed up like that. And you mentioned that this grant sort of got it started. Now, is there a cost to the county yearly from the program?
Yes.
Do you know about how much that's going to be?
About $26,000.
Okay. Very well spent money, in my opinion. And the other thing is, okay, when you have people that don't have access to internet, and I'm thinking maybe out there with some of our more rural and elderly people, can they sign up over the phone some way?
Sure.
Or
they can call me, they can call the
okay.
information, and we look for them.
Because I think of them a lot, because I know one time I remember we had a really, really bad snowstorm, and it ended up involving the sheriff's office going in four-wheel drives to deliver insulin and medicine to elderly and all that kind of thing. See, this is going to be so helpful to alert people ahead of time. And thank you for all your work you put into it.
Well, and as we continue to grow, our initial impact is the early notification for emergencies.
Mm-hmm.
But as we get more comfortable and we begin to expand, basically the expansion is up to us.
Will you ever integrate over like if the Blacksburg, you know, they have their alert system? I guess there'd be some times where you both are sending out the same information.
We
maybe in a different form.
When we did the population and we purchased, we included the entire population of Montgomery County, including town of Christiansburg and town of Blacksburg. Right now, both of their systems are at a renewal point, and we're trying to bring them on board with us, since we're already paying for the system that includes their citizens.
That would be great.
Have one system do all.
Like the dispatch.
Absolutely.
Wow.
That's the ultimate goal.
Cooperation between all agencies. Thank you.
Supervisor Creed.
I have already written down all my little things that I need to go, and we're good.
Supervisor Perkins.
I can just say ditto to what's been said already. I think there are just multitudes of ways that we can have this system help us, and just as we go along, as Big said, as we go along, we will add things to it that are so important to people. And people like me, what happens, out there that we might not be listening to the radio or the TV, or suppose all of the electricity goes out, what do we do,
And one thing that I failed to mention, that's the nice part, this is a system that will call until you respond. And that's how I get my messages from Virginia Department of Emergency Management. I'll get a call. If I don't respond to it and recognize it, I continue to get a call until I do. And that's a nice part too. You say, well, it's nothing, it's just a text message. You're going to hear it until you respond.
And I think that's so helpful for every citizen, but particularly I think more of the elderly citizens now that need to have this and wouldn't be tuned in to a lot of other things. So thank you again. This is a really good thing.
Supervisor King.
I just got one thing. I appreciate you doing that, Mr. Neal.
I didn't do it. It's definitely a team effort.
Team effort. Appreciate you saying that. Recognize everybody. And I do want to go off course just for a second.
Sure.
I just want to tell you how much I appreciate that fundraiser you've done Saturday. You coordinated you, and I want to thank David Duncan for sponsoring it. And it's for the Emergency Training Center down Blacksburg. David Duncan had the second one.
Second one.
And I appreciate everybody that come out and supported that.
I got to drive a Mustang, but they did put a driver in there with me or somebody to supervise, so I didn't go too fast. But I appreciated my test drive.
But you didn't realize he had a button in his hand that he could stop.
I looked over and I said, have you seen that commercial where Jeff Gordon gets all disguised up and takes somebody for a test drive? And he looked at me and said, no, I'm from Minnesota. I don't know anything about that NASCAR stuff.
I just want to say that while you was here, I really honestly appreciate you and David Duncan for doing that.
I appreciate that. David is 100% all in for helping. We've actually scheduled the next one. So,
good deal. I've got a few questions, and I want to make sure, and I think some of the times you covered it in your presentation. Right now, if you're signed up for certain things, but let's say that someone escapes, and the sheriff says, puts out alert, will that go out to everybody who signed up, and there's, even though there was no selection for that type of emergency?
Absolutely. That is the true meaning of an emergency alert. Now, that would only, it'll have to meet certain criteria, which an escape certainly would, but then as soon as that announcement is deemed, we need to put it on citizens alert. You know, 30 seconds later, it's out.
So you don't have to sign up, because I was looking for that when I was signing up.
Yeah, that's what you're going to get.
And as far as this information, is it confidential? Is it going to be provided to any other entity in any way, shape, or form?
No.
So if I'm giving it to you and you're not selling it to somebody else or anything along those lines, right?
Except for your information.
Okay, yeah. Well, that's fine.
No. When the subscriber, you know, dials in and does their own thing, it's not something that we have access to send to a mailing list or create a mailing list from. Now, we can communicate back to you only through the system.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you answering my questions.
Thank you.
Does that spark any other additional questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Next on our agenda is public address. This is our opportunity to listen to the citizens. Each citizen will be given 5 minutes to be able to address the board. Please state your name and address. And we've got several people signed up, and then we'll go with folks off the list. The first on the list is Kenneth Hester.
My name is Kenneth Hester. I live at 120 Alexa Lane, Christiansburg. I will be speaking to you tonight about our newly formed citizen support group for the Montgomery County Sheriff's Office. Okay, we're having our official launch this week for our citizen support group. We've contacted media, we've used social media. We've also had an interview today with Channel 10 WSLS, and to just kind of get information out about our group. The first thing I wanted to talk about a little bit is why I want to present to you. The reason we presented to you is we want you to be aware of us. We obviously would like to have your support when you're talking to your constituents. But also, our actual group started right about there in January. Sheriff Parton asked my wife, Fran, and I if we would spearhead forming a group for the Sheriff's Department. So we thought it was kind of appropriate to finish our week of communicating to ourselves, kind of where we started as the Board of Supervisors. But before we get started talking about us, we need to do some special thanks. That same night, Sheriff Parton introduced us to Cindy and Bill Turner, and subsequently we got introduced to Rhonda Rash. They belong to the Christiansburg Citizen Support Group, and they were very instrumental in meeting with us at the start. They shared their information with us, lessons learned they had. They shared some of their documents. If you've been involved with this process, it takes a lot of time. There's a lot of information to get incorporated, and they basically helped us get off and running, and we wouldn't be where we are today without them. So we thank them before we thank you again. We started in January, as I said, and it takes a long time for this to happen. The first thing we had to do was get our articles of incorporation in place. Those were approved on April the 19th. Once that was done, then we could go for our nonprofit status, which we received on May the 2nd. But the one thing we saw was we continued to work through that process. A slogan kept coming out, and that was serving those who continue to serve us. And any of you who've been involved with the Sheriff's Department know that they do that each and every day. All the first responders do, but obviously we're deeply associated with the Sheriff's Department. From our mission statement and our bylaws, it's a lot of words that boil down to basically three things, and I'll talk to you more about those in just a second. But it's acknowledging life events, supporting the community events that they do, the foster community relations, and people understanding more about what the Sheriff Department offers and programs, and also assisting them as they request any type of effort that they might have. In terms of acknowledging their life events, they have a lot of celebrations. We want to be part of that. We're going to be integrating ourselves into doing that. But there are also times which are sad times or bad times. We want to be there to help support them during those times too. In terms of supporting events to foster community awareness, if you or anyone who can hear me right now has not followed the Sheriff's Office on Facebook, you should. They have information over there virtually daily, but certainly several times a week, that tells you what's going on with them. There's a number of programs they have. Just to touch on a couple, in the upper right-hand corner is a senior citizens group. They have a thing that we supported in Christiansburg last week at the Rec for Senior Citizens. In the lower right is a group of Boy Scouts giving a tour of the jail. In the upper left, we see a group of children that are working with the police officers. And then in the very center where you see the gentleman with the cross, that was an internet safety thing that happened at one of the local churches within a week of when the little girl Nicole died recently, to make people aware of that. So they're involved in a lot of programs, things such as Project Lifesaver, DARE, and a number. And also, if you notice on the very bottom, they also have a little bit of time for fun. That was the famous donkey basketball game that happened recently, and I didn't get to go to that because I was someplace else, but I understand that was a lot of fun. So. And then, of course, assisting them as requested. Now, what we're looking at there is primarily events, as you heard with the alert we just had, and I've signed up for that. It was very great. I got three alerts about lightning the other day, like bam, bam, bam. But to help them when they have organized things, such as a drug raid, and they have a logistical issue where they might be there for several hours, and they might need water, drinks, maybe a snack, something such as that. That's a picture from the flood we had. I think it was last year when that occurred. And there was a lot of officers who were out helping citizens who basically could not get to a restaurant or McDonald's. So we have intentions to help create an inventory through supportive citizens and businesses throughout the county, and have an inventory so when something like that occurs, it's available and we just help get it out to them. The last thing I have is how you can contact us. Okay, you can reach us at our email site or like us on Facebook. We obviously will be glad to accept donations from citizens or any businesses. We left out at the counter some information about how to contact us.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hester.
And in closing, as I'm closing, I know my time is up. First time I ran out of time. To promote our the start today, I have a little memento. Quickly, the date only is the date that we actually were incorporated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. That's very nice.
Thank you, Ken.
That's beautiful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
That's a little man.
The next citizen to sign up is Joel Irvine. Please state your name and address, and you have 5 minutes.
Joel Irvine, 515 Farmingdale Lane in Blacksburg. So in light of tonight's resolution vote about the 460 North Main intersection in Blacksburg, I just wanted to take a minute to pass on some thank yous to everyone involved so far in the process. I think we've come a long way. So I'm going to say when the interchange is constructed. I am an optimist, so I'll stick to that. But I think when it is constructed, I think we're going to look back on this last 3 or 4 months where a lot of work has gotten done and understand how pivotal it was in the planning period. I think the efforts of the county involved in directing that planning will not be forgotten. Certainly not by me. So in that order, I want to thank specifically, first of all, the entire Board of Supervisors. Thank you very much for your support. Mr. Meadows and his staff in the Administrator's Office. A lot of help I know goes on in the background. Ms. Sweeney for all of her coordinating efforts. We've asked for some last minute things to get this going, and that was very helpful. And finally, all other county employees that have been involved in the process. So I encourage everyone to support the resolution tonight. Thank the board again for its responsiveness and its advocacy on our behalf. I know we're not close to being done, but I think we've had a heck of a start. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Next citizen signed up is Mode Johnson. Please state your name and address, and you'll have 5 minutes.
Thank you. My name is Mode Johnson. I live at 3030 Mount Tabor Road. I'm going to talk about the infamous hairpin turn on Mount Tabor. If you've never seen it or been through it, I would invite you to do so. Now is a great time to sit because it's been hit recently. And I think you all have a document that I provided and some photographs. I am requesting the board to ask VDOT to restrict tractor-trailer trucks and long load vehicles on State Route 624, which is Mount Tabor Road, due to the very tight turn radius hairpin turn. It's approximately 4.5 miles from North Main Street. Many tractor-trailer trucks, and including one mobile home, has been stuck on that curve. And it ends up blocking that pressure point for hours, up to 4 hours and maybe even more. We live in the country, our detours are not around the block. And I'll explain, our detours are fairly long. And why does it take so long? One reason is these are very, very big items that get stuck in this tight turn. They can't back up. There's no way to get out of this situation without very large wreckers and forklifts. And many times they have to come from Roanoke. So there's a lot of travel time involved for the forklifts and the wreckers to get these large objects off the guardrail and able to leave the scene. What happens when it blocks up? Obviously, the people out there can't get to where they want to go. They can't get to town. They can't get home, to work, to any appointments. Well, say take a detour. The detour on Mount Tabor Road after the hairpin turn is Dry Run Road. I hope you all get a chance to go down that sometime. It's a one-lane gravel road. The next one, and the only other one, is Galleon Ridge Road. Now it is two-lane, but it's also gravel. So those are our two detours to get around that curve on Mount Tabor if it is blocked. And also, and it hasn't happened yet, thank God, if something got stuck there that had hazardous materials and had to leak, that curve is right over Mill Creek. And if anything leaks into Mill Creek, we have well water that could be contaminated and obviously a lot of livestock that is downstream. Several years ago, VDOT, in my encouragement, said they'll look at it, and they did. And they put up signs at each end of Mount Tabor Road. And it says, tractor, trailer, traffic, not recommended. Basically, a little sign underneath it says, don't believe your GPS. GPS is not advised. After the sign went up, traffic was reduced, but the problem is it's not eliminated. As recently as May 12th, 11 days ago, another truck got stuck. It was at least over 4 hours until it could be released. So you can imagine, once you get stuck in these, you don't forget them. There's not a lot of tractor-trailer traffic on Mount Tabor, but if there's any, they're going to get stuck at one time or another. And I think it's a win-win situation. It benefits everybody if we can get the trucks off of there. First responders need to get the people after the hairpin turn. If they can't go on Mount Tabor, they have to do Dry Run or Galleon Ridge Road, it's going to double or triple their response time to citizens out there. And obviously there are hundreds of people that live past that turn on Dry Run. The truck drivers and the owners, they're going to save money because they're going to get to where they're going on time and they're not going to have damage to their rigs. So I don't think they really want, to have to be late or have a big expense. So I think it's going to benefit them. And obviously we won't have hazardous materials in the water, so it's going to benefit everybody. Therefore, I'm requesting again that Mount Tabor needs to be restricted to through truck traffic for the health, safety, and welfare of Montgomery County citizens. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. The next citizen signed up is Sandy Slawdecker. Thank you very, very much. You have 5 minutes. Please state your name and address.
Sandy Schlatter, 425 Fortress Drive, Blacksburg, Virginia. I sent all of you a letter that is a letter written by the county administrator from Roanoke. I hope you all have it. I just wanted to kind of let the audience know what the county administrator in Roanoke is doing. There were 4.5 pages of verbiage, which I'm not going to go through, but they also added some attachments, maps of things that they talked about, which I thought were very helpful, hopefully for the people at the FERC. And this is on the soil erosion hazard, and the last one was on, which I thought was very interesting. And the other thing I liked also was that they did include a little bit of Montgomery County here. But this is on the percentage of slope that there is along the pipeline and how dangerous it is. My concern is, and what I'd like to ask you for, is I'm not sure how they came up with this letter. I don't know who's doing the research for them, but obviously somebody's, they've gone into this and they've found discrepancies. And I won't say about the honesty of Mountain Valley Pipeline, but inaccuracies in what Mountain Valley has sent to the FERC. And I am concerned that there are also many inaccuracies about what Mountain Valley has sent to the FERC regarding what's going on in our county. And I'm wondering if there's anybody that's looking through the letters that MVP is sending to the FERC and making sure that what they are saying is accurate, and if it's not accurate, if they are then sending letters such as this one that the Roanoke County Administrator wrote to the FERC to make them aware of the inaccuracies. So I would like to ask the board to either have staff or someone look at what is being presented, reading the different documents that are going to the FERC specifically for Montgomery County, and if there are inaccuracies, that they be brought to the attention of FERC. I also, unrelated, am in favor of doing something with the 460 interchange because I drive through that every day, many times. And also, I think having the tractor trailers off Mount Tabor would be an excellent idea. I was there today. I saw what the guardrail looks like at that hairpin curve, and it still has not been fixed, which to me is also a hazard. And I think it would be a great thing to ban all long trucks off that road. Because there might be some MVP that might also not be able to use it then. Thank you very much.
That is all of the citizens who have been signed up to speak. If there are other citizens that would like to address the board, please come forward.
Good evening. I'm Diana Richardson, 1431 Breckenridge Drive, Blacksburg, Virginia. I did not intend to address you, but you know, I'm up here anyway. I am a representative for an advocacy group, Preserve Montgomery County, that cares very much for the safety and the environment in Montgomery County, and that is the reason that we I propose is the Mountain Valley Pipeline. I just wanted to tell you how much I appreciate Mr. Tuck and I guess Mr. Meadows too, doing some research on behalf of the citizens of Montgomery County and looking and in trying to find a law firm to assist in looking at the problems for the county that the Mountain Valley Pipeline may cause. I have been made aware just today, this afternoon, from speaking to Giles and Craig County that there may be some issues for sure with the firm that we had talked about last month, the law firm of Water and Power Law. That there may be a conflict of interest in representing our county because of perhaps some differing resolutions. And I'm sure that Mr. Tuck and Mr. Meadows probably know more about this than I. But I was also told by representatives from the groups in those two counties that they still thought that there were ways that we might be able to work out those issues. Again, I just found out about it this afternoon, or I would have contacted you all before I got up here to speak. I just want to say that the only reason that I continue to bring up that particular law firm are two. And the first is that they are working with the other counties around, so they know our region, they know our particular area, and they're already working for them, so they're up to speed. And another law firm, even if it is chosen, I guess would have to get up to speed. The other reason is that we all wanted to do this together. You know, we're kind of in a row here, Craig, Giles, Montgomery, and Roanoke, because if they work for one, they work for all of us. And if they're doing work on a certain issue, then it probably affects the other counties too. So we see it as a money-saving issue, and we're known that you all are really aware of saving money, as we are too. So I just wanted to, I guess, say that I'm hoping that we can come up with a solution that will be the most cost-effective and will be the best for our county. And maybe we can still continue to look into this issue. Thank you very much.
Are there any, there we go. Please state your name and address, and you'll have 5 minutes.
My name is Linda Majors. I'm at 2620 Mount Tabor Road, and I'm here specifically to support Mo Johnson's request for restricting long load vehicles on Mount Tabor Road because of the hairpin turn. I live at the top of the hill, so I'm not affected by that because I go to town. You know, the hairpin curve is not between me and town. But when I called several people today to say this is going to be on the agenda and doesn't want to speak, they couldn't come, but one person said, oh yeah, that happens all the time. The other person said, yeah, it just happened again, probably on May 12th. And he said, you know, when it's a very narrow, steep, you have a steep drop off on one side, you have a rock wall on the other with just a slight ditch. And he said, you know, you get down the bottom and then you have to turn around, which is by inches. And so it's definitely a huge safety issue, even when you are not involved in being stuck on the hairpin curve. Mountain Valley Pipeline Mount Tabor Variation is less than half a mile beyond that. So if they're going to take Colbank Hollow Road, which they probably will, and go down, hit Mount Tabor, go through the hairpin curve, the variation within 0.2 of a mile of a hairpin turn is right next to the road, goes along the road, past Mode's house, and then crosses the road. So obviously they're going to be wanting to use that. This is going to be a huge problem, with because they're not going to have small trucks, and there's going to be a lot of traffic there. So that's another reason to restrict these long loads here. It's a huge safety issue. The other thing I wanted to say is that I support the grade separated interchange on North Main and 460 for the same reason. Those big, if something goes in on Mount Tabor Road, and either it's alternate 200 or Mount Tabor variation, either one of them at this point in time, there's going to be huge accidents, problems, traffic, unbelievable. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any other citizens who would like to come forward and address the board?
Javato Ranger, 1600 Winslow Drive, Blacksburg. I'd like to thank you very much for
your support of the full interchange in Northwest Blacksburg. The proposed plan will definitely be a county problem as well. Some of you were present during the work session where the town's assistant manager provided background information for the current proposal. It was obvious that applying for the VDOT funding was a hasty decision and could have benefited from engaging the public and the county. Also, I believe the sale of the Blacksburg Old Middle School property would have benefited from a similar collaboration and perhaps certain compromises at earlier stages. It would have yielded a better outcome. Again, I thank you very much for your support, and I ask you to be careful deciding the fate of the old high school property. Let's have a constructive dialogue with the town of Blacksburg to produce a win-win situation.
Thank you. Are there any other citizens who would like to come forward to address the board? Mr. Turner, would you please state your name and address?
My name is Bill Turner. I live at 1690 Gillett Road in Christiansburg. I do work a lot of work out in the Mount Tabor area, and I work at the cemetery that's there at 460 and North Main Street. I also do a lot of fish fries for the Mount Tabor Rotary Club, Merlin Club. But we have our ranking coming up the second Saturday in June, by the way. But I'm out in that area not only just for those two purposes, but I also perform work for various residents along the way. There are a number of elderly residents down that road, and it's not just this one hairpin curve that is a problem for large trucks. You sometimes can't even hardly get past a 24-foot U-Haul truck on the curb at Colbank Hollow Road, and also when you get down to the S-curve that's just past Colbank Hollow Road. So all of these areas are very unnegotiable when there's a large truck coming in. If you take someone who's not an experienced driver, like someone driving a U-Haul truck, they don't know how to negotiate exactly, and if you are face-to-face with one of these trucks, it can be pretty scary. So I do find in favor of limiting either the length or banning the trucks entirely. Like I said, a 24 or 26 footer truck is really big enough. The other thing is that I am in full support and do ask that you support a permanent solution and resolution to the 460 bypass issue. I do hope y'all pass that resolution and hope that we can get the other entities on board to realize that there is only one real true solution to this, and that's a permanent solution. The other thing is that I'd like to thank Ken and Fran for recognizing my wife and I. We really did very little, but we are members of the Christiansburg Police Support Group. We would like to be members of the Montgomery County Sheriff's Office Support Group. We think our law enforcement in this area is some of the absolute best this country has to offer. Until you get on the inside of these, and I've also, my wife and I have been through the Blacksburg Police Academy for Citizens. We recently graduated from the Montgomery County Sheriff's Office Police Academy for Citizens. And unless you go through one of these academies, you really do not understand what our law enforcement issues and these guys face every day. It's really, truly staggering that we don't have more deaths than we have. And I credit all of the law enforcement people in our area for the cooperation that they provide each other and the first responders in all aspects of our communities, how well they function together as one unit. It's really amazing. But I do thank Sheriff Parton for going ahead and moving forward on our support for the sheriff's office. You really, really don't understand possibly the help that these guys and ladies do need. But anything that the county can do as the Board of Supervisors can offer them in the way of support, I greatly encourage you to please do so. But these guys do deserve a tremendous amount of respect for the job that they do each and every day. They truly put their lives on the line. And it's not just one or two that are patrolling, it's all of them. They all will do the very same for each and every one of us. And I think we need to stand up for them and let them know we do support them. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to address the board? Going once, going twice. Closed as far as public address. I don't recall that there's an addendum.
No, sir. Not tonight.
Is there a motion in regards to consent agenda?
Motion.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Ms. Parks?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Is there a motion in regards to work session?
Motion.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7 ayes.
We're in work session, and I guess I'll start down with Mr. King. Do you have any comments in regards to the Mount Tabor situation at this point in time?
Well, I feel sorry for the people that's going through that. I really do, because if each year is where I've been bringing it up about pig path. The only thing is, like I was told, you have to have a different route that these trucks can take. And you know, on pig path, you know, they got 81 Route 8, and I still haven't cured that one yet. But I feel for these people that lives down there has to go through it. I really do.
How long have you been working on that issue?
A year.
And can you, to help us understand, help the citizens understand, what has been a part of the process that you've been working on out there?
Well, there's different criteria you got to have. You got to have so many houses. The way it was explained to me, so many houses, you got to have, there's got to be a wreck on there, an actual wreck. And when I talked to VDOT about it, I had everything in order except for a wreck. 2-3 days later, we had a logging truck roll over. So I sent them pictures of that. I mean, there are just different criteria that you have to have before you can. And you can't blame VDOT for this, because you know they don't want to just shut a road down if they don't have, you know, a different route to go. But I'm not saying that I'm against this. I mean, because you know, I'll vote for resolution to send to VDOT to slow the trucks down. But there's just, if I'd thought about it, I'd brought the packet tonight, because they sent me a big thick packet of what you got to do before they can even think about shutting one down for big trucks.
Supervisor Perkins?
Well, this happens to be in my district, and it is obviously a hazard for the people who have to travel the road every day. I do understand that on some roads, it's just not made for huge trucks, and they can be restricted. I know that you do have to have an alternative route, but it seems to me that as they come down the mountain and they get to 460, I mean, they're on 460, and there's no reason they can't go out any one of the areas that 460 goes, maybe through the more business districts. You know, for a very long period of time, there have been no trucks going through, very large trucks going through Blacksburg. Well, I haven't really paid much attention to Christiansburg, because I live in Blacksburg and try those all the time. I now am seeing many more tractor-trailer type trucks, very large trucks, going through the town of Blacksburg down Main Street, because it is, the bypass is there too, as well. And there are trucks that have to go in there for, through the town of Blacksburg for food, for, you know, servicing various people there. But I think if there's nothing that can be done with a hairpin curve, then it seems to me that the logical thing would be to restrict large trucks going through there. That road's not very wide anyway. And so it's one of those things where if you've got people who need to be in a certain place at a certain time and they're going through pretty fast, and then they get stuck, what happens to the rest of the people who need to go and come through that road?
Do you think it's a matter of like logging trucks, or is it people making deliveries, or a combination?
I really don't know. Perhaps we can ask.
Inquire at VDOT through the state police or the sheriff's department about the accident reports.
Right. I think the accident reports that are there are they're very specific. So it wouldn't be a problem finding out what those are. Could we ask him?
We can.
Since it's a work session.
Can I add a couple of things?
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead.
One of the things when this came up last week, and I apologize that we didn't get the information out to the entire board on what the VDOT requirements are. Judy Kaiser in our office had pulled, I think I sent it to,
right.
To the two of y'all, and then there was an issue with it opening. But
right.
Judy also discussed it with Dan Brew, who Dan, of course, is a retired resident engineer for VDOT that works with the MPO. And Dan suggested that one of the things the board may want to do if you want to pursue this is ask David Clark and VDOT to research the history of the accidents on Mount Tabor, including how many, how often, what kinds of trucks, before starting the process, because as Supervisor King mentioned, that is one thing that they will ask for is not only, disabled vehicles, but they look at the accident history.
Yeah.
And if I may, Mr. Chair, there in that document that I was referring to, there's four criteria that it says that VDOT looks for. The local governing body must hold a public hearing, make a formal request, and the following four things must be adhered to. Public notices for the hearing must include a description of the through truck restriction and the alternate route with the same termini. A public hearing must be held by the local governing body and the transcript of the hearing provided with the resolution. The resolution must describe the proposed through truck restriction and a description of the alternate. And the governing body must include in the resolution that it will use its good offices for enforcement of the proposed restriction. And it says failure to comply with these four items will result in the request being returned. So they're very specific about what they require the governing body to provide to them before they'll do anything.
Right. And we have a copy of that in our packets for today. And so I would propose that we, what you're saying, that we get with VDOT. I mean, certainly we have to. That's the first step. Secondly, we've also heard from the citizens that are here and from that live out there. I'm not sure how many of them are involved yet, but it would seem to me that needs to be widely the fact that we would have a public hearing, or that we've even asked for it, that they would know, the citizens in that area need to be aware of what we're doing. And I think that talking, maybe having our administrators talk with VDOT for a while. I know you say you already have, but now it seems to me that it's a little bit more official and permanent.
Right.
And I think it would be important to have you all, Marty too, working with these people that have really control over the roads more than we do. I think we can ask for these things, but VDOT is the one that we've got to convince and have to follow their instructions and their restrictions. But I really think that knowing what it's like to have these very, very large trucks who cannot go around a part of a road, and yet they want to get from point A to point B as quickly as they can. I think it's imperative for the safety of our citizens and the welfare of our citizens to pursue this. I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but you've been pursuing it a long time, and I think through this work session or through this gathering of just beginning information that we encourage study of this and know what we can do to help citizens.
And it sounds like, from what Craig is saying, we're going to have to be able to document and say there was May the 12th, April the 10th, and
right.
such on, and to be able to document those
one
vehicles
piece that, you've got to have,
that so. We've got to have, and then we're going to need to work on trying to find an alternative route to a very rural area, which
I
is going to
answer that, if I may interrupt. I don't know if
go
I'm
ahead.
Or not.
Yes, Mr. Meadows.
I did, Mr. Meadows, forward me that VDOT requirements, uh-huh. and so my memo to you really goes through those requirements. Mm-hmm. I called VDOT mm-hmm. and talked to Mr. Clark and Mr. Price. So I said, I don't know what an alternate route is. What do you suggest? They said route 42 to 311. So that was their suggestion for an alternate route.
Mm-hmm. All right, so 40.
Newport. You're going to go through right. Newport to Newcastle.
Yeah. To Newcastle and then
okay.
to 311 and get around to
right. Roanoke. So that was their suggestion, not mine.
But that's
okay.
good enough.
And obviously you can go 460 to 81 too if you want to go.
Yeah, well that's what I was saying. You're on 460, they're on 460. They could continue over to 81. We have a bypass for that very reason, is to keep those very large trucks from coming through Main Street unless they have to for whatever reason, but I don't think they'd have to. I think that there's that route of staying on 460 until you get to 81 is the appropriate way to go.
Supervisor Creed.
Yeah, just a couple of little things. One of the things that I got in this week was someone wrote a little something for me to read, and it said one of the roads that comes out from over there is, if you have to go the back way, there's two of them, and they have gravel to run on. Well, you know, believe me, if we had gravel to run on down in Charlottesville and Elliston and some of these places that I am from, we would be happier than a pig in mud, because you know what we usually get is just mud after the first hour or two of people running on the roads that we have. So I think that a major thing would be to make sure that you're not asking for something that everybody else has already got, because that is what they are saying that they've got, and I have no reason to believe that that isn't the truth.
Well, you remember Mr. Creed, he did say something about Dry Run and Galleon Road. Well, those are not really three roads.
No, they're gravel.
Yeah, they're gravel. Whereas if you keep out on 460, or if you have that route from 42 to up to, I know, Newcastle, not that we want to, you know, just put traffic yeah. through that area.
Actually, that's where they have to go if they need a
right.
place.
Supervisor Biggs.
Well, number one, I would suggest that we ask right away for the guardrail to be fixed.
Yeah.
Because that's, I mean, for it to be like that is not acceptable. I also heard from people that were talking about when there is a road blockage and they're trying to get to the doctors and having trouble and getting to the doctors in a timely manner, and then that would lead me to think that emergency vehicles would have problems also.
Right.
So I think it is a safety issue. I think that we should follow up on the protocol that has been set forth through VDOT, and I think we should work with our citizens, and if need be, we've done this in the past when there's a big road issue. We've held a community meeting, and so we could hold a community meeting out in that area. So, you know, there are a lot of people that live out there. That is a growing area of Blacksburg and going out from Blacksburg into the county. So I say we should do everything we can to address the concern as best we can and with the protocol given.
Sure.
Supervisor DeMotts?
Just a couple of things. First, I think it's important to say that it's been probably about two years since I've driven through that section of the road, so that will be something that I do this week, just to familiarize myself with the area. But because it's been so long, I don't recall a lot of businesses along the road, so I guess my primary question would be, where are the trucks going? Why are they on the road to begin with? I definitely would support asking Mr. Clark to research accidents and figuring out how we can meet the four criteria. If we meet the four criteria that VDOT sets for restricting truck access to the roads. And then I guess in light of Mr. Creed's remarks, I guess whenever we have a citizen's request that comes before us, especially something that restricts a citizen's access to medical, fire, police, emergency type services, I think we should consider it on balance with any other requests from any part of the county. So I certainly would be interested in hearing road issues throughout the county, but this is the one that's before us. So I will be driving it at some point this week just to experience it myself, and I know I'll make it through in my car. I won't take anything bigger out there.
Supervisor Shepherd.
It's been about 6 months since I've been down that road. Prior to that, I've traveled that road pretty regularly going to Newcastle and Roanoke and back, mostly just to get off of 81. And it is a very treacherous highway or road. That curve is really non-negotiable for long trucks, and I totally support banning those trucks. One thing I thought about while everybody was speaking and as you all have been talking is I was trying to think if there were any small businesses that would benefit from having tractor trailers, and I'm not coming up. I know there's one like a little garage down there is the only thing I can think of.
I can't remember a lot of businesses along the route that would need long-haul truck deliveries.
The only thing I was thinking of is agricultural, whether it be logging trucks, that's an agricultural purpose, or every once in a while I don't think there's any more dairies out there anymore. So I don't think that you have the tractor trailer size, and the dairy trucks are smaller now than they used to be also. So I was thinking along those same lines. I will say this, VDOT doesn't always have all the accident reports. And the reason I know that is I dealt with a case over in Giles County and where I was representing someone, and they drove the wrong way through the bluffs. Well, VDOT said, well, we don't have any problems. We only have a couple of accidents. So one of the things, I reached out to the Sheriff's Department and the State Police and found out in about a 16-month period of time, there were 32 calls of people driving the wrong way on that same section of road, and VDOT didn't know about it. And so we might not just ask VDOT, but ask the Sheriff's Department, the 911 dispatch, and the State Police, because a lot of times the State Police will work the accidents. The county does help out working accidents, but on those rural sections. So that might help us get a better and complete picture and reaching out to all those services, because I understand what they're saying. And then if there is occasions where you have somebody who's trying to bring in a mobile home for their new house, they may need to look at a different route, because as someone who has also delivered mobile homes in one part of his life, jacking a mobile home up, and that takes hours. And you're talking about a forklift, or you're talking about a wrecker, and you're talking about cribbing, and it's taken some serious time. So I'm very supportive of looking at this and studying this, but I also want us to move forward where we're organized and we make a really good case for it.
Well, that's what I was beginning to talk about when you asked us before, when talking about our administrators and others, to dig deeply into what it is and talk with whoever is necessary as it's spreads out, to get more information about what's going on, not just talk to one person, but just talk to a group of people so that we can stop it. I personally don't see, I think it's a cut through just so people can get from one road to the other. Remember when we were talking about Craig's Creek and how you only got so far on Craig's Creek? Well, there are a lot of people who live there, just on a citizen such as we are, and people cut through there to save time or not to have to go around or just to get where they want to go. And so I think it's the same kind of thing. They see a road there and they think, okay, we can go this way. And if they I mean, it's just human nature that people are going to do that, but they don't stop to think what kinds of problems that can cause when they do that. So,
well, from the sign, the picture of the sign that was sent to us,
yeah,
if I was to see that sign, GPS routes, not something, I would think, oh, my GPS signal is going to get lost. I should have a paper map.
Yeah.
It just isn't clear from the language on the sign mm-hmm. that it's advising.
Right.
And, well, and I think a lot of tractor trailer drivers, though, they utilize GPS.
Probably.
And that, a lot of times the GPS will say, this is the quickest route, and so they're going to take it, and they don't realize that there's an S curve.
Well, I'll tell you something else about the GPS, and I didn't know this until back in December. We took a trip out west and used the GPS quite a lot. And it will actually tell you if there's traffic stopped or slow on a certain road. So 81's backed up, as it frequently is.
Mm-hmm.
That's might be where that traffic's coming from.
Yeah.
Does that spark any other conversations with any other board members?
No, I want us to pursue it, and I think we as a board need to say thumbs up if that's what we want our administrators and individuals to do. But I think we've all said it, but we need to let you know that that's something we want to take what information you have and use it to our benefit too.
I think that would be a really good investment of our time.
I think so too.
And put in a request to get the guardrail fixed.
Yes.
Absolutely. All right. And Mr. Chair, if I could just add one thing.
Thank you for bringing
Mr. Johnson, I wanted to thank you too. The information you sent to the group, if everybody was that well prepared, that was great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there a motion to go out of work session?
Move.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. King?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMonts?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Ms. Burgess?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye. New business.
I didn't know
now, we've been going about an hour and 15 minutes. Would anyone like to take a break at this
yes.
point?
Yes.
All right. Let's take a 10-minute break, and we'll come back at about 20 till.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And the next item on our agenda is new business. The first new business item is U.S. 460 North Main Street improvements, specifically resolutions supporting the town of Blacksburg, Senator Edwards, and Delegate Yost's efforts to obtain additional funding for a grade separated interchange as a permanent solution to the safety issues at 460 and North Main Street interchange.
I would like to move approval.
And I'd like to second it.
All right. Is there any further discussion before we vote? Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven
ayes. The next item is the treasurer DMV stop fees and transfer from general contingencies for postage and bank fee coverages. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is
second.
There a second? Is there discussion?
Yeah, what's this? It says additional $4,040 is needed to cover a shortfall of health insurance costs and other line items. What's the other?
I'll look to Ms. Edmonds in regards to that.
Well, I can speak to the health insurance, perhaps the treasurer can address any of the other issues, but the shortfall in health insurance generally comes from we budget at a certain period of time during the year with the number of people and the health insurance plans they have at that point in time. If someone after the fiscal years happen, someone elects to, let's say, take coverage for dependents or something, that has an additional cost and that would not have been in the budget. As far as the other line items, I can't address those specifically. I can tell you the majority of that cost is in the health insurance shortfall where there was not an adequate amount in the budget for the choices people made during the year.
Thank you. Is there any other, I'll start with Mr. King. Ms. Perkins, do you have any other questions about this?
Or? Well, just one more
okay.
thing, if you would. When we discussed this before about the bank fees, and it was $18,000, and now it's moved up to $20,000.
Mr. King, I understand. I agree. It continues to concern me that amount continues to grow. That's about a 10% increase from the initial request, which was asked for.
Well, can we not ask the treasurer what the problem is?
Sure.
Because he's sitting right there.
Okay, go ahead.
Please.
There's one new problem. It was estimated to cost $18,000. Now, to get us to the 2016 year end, it's going to cost us $2,000 more, which is $20,000 total. That's what we're requesting. It is a bill. It needs to be paid. That's all I can say, is that what it cost us to use the services got to $20,000. That should be basically the high of it each year. We've had this for a couple years, and it's just now coming about, y'all talking about it. Not that it's hid or anything like that. It's a cost like anything else we do for the county. And this $2,000 more needs to be paid.
So, like, you're estimating that each year will cost about $20,000?
Hopefully that will be basically it.
Okay.
Now, our budget being $183 million this year, with the cost of doing business may increase some because our budget's $5, $6 million higher. That would be the only cost difference. The cost that would cost the bank to provide these services for us. We don't use the services, certainly there's not a cost. But size government that Montgomery County has become, we will be paying fees.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions from other supervisors?
No, I've witnessed fees being charged by other banks. Just for using a credit card on that bank's account. Yeah. So they'll charge you X number of dollars to use it.
And we had asked you beforehand, and then the banking decision is yours. Which bank that you're, and at that point in time, you felt like $18,000 was going to be our cap.
I didn't think that. I just said that's what it was at that time. We estimated 18,000.
Okay. So your estimate was off by about 10%. So at this point in time, does that give you any more reasons to start looking for other banks potentially that are not going to have $20,000 in annual?
No, it doesn't. Because other banks will have similar fees, if not the same or higher.
And you understand that we had some banks who contacted us after the last discussion.
I understand that.
Okay.
Haven't had anybody contact me.
Thank you. Does that spark any further discussion in regards to the Board of Supervisors?
Mm-mm. If it's a bill that's been sent.
I agree that we have to pay our bills. I continue to be concerned when I have banks who've contacted us who want to do and said that they wouldn't be charging those type of fees. I know that they contacted Supervisor King. I received some contacts as well. I continue to have some very, $20,000 is a lot of money. And yes, we have a $183 million budget, but in my mind, if we look out for the $20,000s and the $15,000s, that takes care of the $100,000s. If we take care of the $100,000s, that takes care of the millions. But this isn't a decision that we get to make as a board. The citizens of Montgomery County have to pay the bill.
Did these other banks, which I'm not aware of, were they able to handle the large sums of money that we have and that we deal with?
From our discussions after that last meeting, when Mr. Shelton was present there, he had several banks contact us and saying that yes, and that they would be willing to talk about the fees.
Did those banks, did we then encourage them to contact? He has not received any contacts from banks.
That's because he said he wasn't going to send it out.
If you will recall at the last meeting, he said he was not going to do any additional bids. He was not going to address any further.
But I would think if we have salesmen calling on us, it's not our job to choose the bank. Mm-hmm. They would be soliciting business from Mr. Shelton, so it would be our responsibility to refer them to Mr. Shelton.
If you recall, Mr. Shelton said he was not interested in receiving any of those bids for a period of time until this contract expired. Even though that we could get out of the contract prior to that, he expressed that he was not in going to do that. If you're a businessman or a salesperson and the fellow who gets to make the decision says, I'm not going to hear it, there's not
much. Well, I have salespeople that visit me at my office every single week, and I don't do business with them. So I would think that it would be in our best interest to refer those folks directly to Mr. Shelton so they can begin to establish a relationship. So if at some point he chooses to solicit bids for more services, then he already has established relationships with other banks.
I appreciate you bringing that up because
We did refer those banks to him and give him the names and addresses, and as I said, he stated at our meeting he was not interested in their bids. We can provide the minutes from the meeting, and we can provide a copy of the videotape for him if we would like to be able to.
I'm not questioning the accuracy of what you're saying. I'm just saying that it's incumbent on those salespeople to contact Mr. Shelton directly.
Well, it'd be nice if we knew what the other banks had said, you know, as a board, and that what they wanted to charge. I mean, we don't make that decision. Mr. Shelton makes that decision. Mm-hmm. It's his completely. It's your decision. But it would be interesting just to know who they were, because I certainly didn't hear.
Todd, do you remember off the top of your head, if I know that one of the banks was the hometown bank, and yours was First Bank. So those are the two banks that expressed some interest in it. I know that we contacted, that they could reached out to us after the last meeting when we talked about the fees and how that many banks want to have a large deposit and business. But again, that's your decision. You get to make
most
it.
Most banks cannot use the general funds that we have. Got a statement today, we have $43 million in the bank. Most hometown banks cannot use that kind of money in their operations. It's way too much money for them to loan.
Does any board members have any additional questions they would like to of the treasurer?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
There's a motion and a second. Mm-hmm. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Moss?
Aye.
Ms. Bitts?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
I continue to have reservations, but I believe that we as a county have to pay our bills, and this is a bill that we owe, and so I will vote aye.
Seven ayes.
County Attorney's Report.
No report, Mr.
County Administrator's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Two items. I just wanted to, he's not back there anymore. I was going to congratulate the sheriff and the folks at the sheriff's office for the great memorial dedication ceremony and law enforcement day we had last Monday. Had a huge turnout. Weather held up for us, which was great. A very, very moving ceremony, and certainly appreciate all the hard work that went into that. Kim, if you can share that with all the folks, we really appreciate the invitation to be over there. And just one other item, speaking of the sheriff's office and the public safety building, we had our 911 authority board meeting today, and the next 60 days for the 911 authority are going to be quite busy. If everything goes as planned, by the end of July, we will be operating a consolidated 911 facility with all four jurisdictions. There's still a few hurdles to get over. Verizon picked a really interesting time to go on strike. But I think we've, even with that, we heard this morning at our meeting, I think we've overcome that hurdle. So things are moving forward. Donna Brown has done, and her staff have done a fabulous job in getting that facility ready to go. Once things are operational, I hope to be able to take you guys over there in a couple months and give you a tour. And you're always welcome to drop in anytime and visit as well. But that'll be a reality soon. And that's all I have.
Supervisor Creed?
No.
Supervisor Biggs?
Okay, I attended two meetings last Wednesday. The first one started off in Galax, and that was the Workforce Consortium board meeting. And I'm still learning a lot about that because it's sort of overwhelming. There's so many different facets of it that to try to learn all the language they use and all the programs they have, I'm just really grateful that Marty Holliday, the executive director, can explain things. And we, she did file her rapid response implementation plan, and I was able to be part of the meeting for that earlier on, I guess about maybe a month ago. Then I went to the library board meeting, and most of you probably know that Paula Austin, our director, gave her her information out that she would be leaving within the year. She had, in fact, she said, well, I only have 50 more weeks. And the whole board was like, well, we knew you had talked about this, but then when you actually give your letter, that makes it real. And you know, Paula has just done an outstanding job for our library system. And she's trying to leave time for the library board of trustees to seek a really qualified candidate and hopefully be able to work with that person maybe for a week before they take over. But to me, she's just irreplaceable. But that was the sad news. After she said that, we were just like, well, that was a way to ruin the night, but we understand and we wish her well, but it's going to go fast. It's going to go fast. The other thing I wanted to ask about was sort of following up on Ms. Richardson's comment. Are we going to do anything about continuing to look at the law firm for the Mountain Valley Pipeline? Are we going to really try to figure out if there's a conflict with the one, or are we going to look at another one, or what are we going to do exactly? Has there been an attempt for us to communicate with any way with the Giles and the Craig County people that have been involved? I don't know. I just wonder what we're going to do next, and I would be interested in knowing what the plan is.
And I'll try to address some of that in the board report and share with the email.
The people coming out tonight for the two road issues. Yay. That's all.
Supervisor DeMonts.
Just a couple of things very quick. First, I had the privilege and honor this weekend of attending Christiansburg High School's graduation ceremony. Now, I did attend because my stepdaughter was graduating, but much to my family's amusement, I cried from the time it started until the time it finished. It was just very touching. I look forward to attending more of our county high school's graduation ceremonies next year, because it was a very well done ceremony. So I want to congratulate all of our high school graduates that just celebrated this past weekend and wish them all of the best for their future. Also wanted to echo what you said, Mr. Meadows, about the law enforcement officers memorial ceremony. That was a very nice ceremony. And then also to thank the citizen support group for the sheriff's office for this very nice memento. This is a great end to the week, I guess, law enforcement officers memorial week. This is a great capper to put on that week. So thank you very much for presenting those to us. Two more things. Want to encourage everybody to sign up for the Citizen Alert, just to reiterate what Mr. Turner was saying earlier. And then I also wanted to encourage people to come into downtown Blacksburg. We're quite slow now. We've lost a lot of our student residents, so if there's any restaurants or businesses that you'd like to visit in Blacksburg, now is certainly the time.
And they tend to be full.
Supervisor Shepherd.
The only thing I have is just to tell you there's no Economic Development Commission meeting this month.
Supervisor King.
Well, I went to a couple of graduations, and I thought all of them done really well. I think Auburn had a big class with 91 this time. I was telling somebody out there when my sister graduated several years ago, they had 10.
Wow.
But I usually try to thank a group of people when I'm up here, and I want to look at y'all and tell y'all how much I appreciate y'all helping me as long as I've been on this board. I mean, each one of you has done something special for me, and I appreciate each and every one of you.
Thank you. Supervisor Perkins.
Well, I appreciate you, and I know the rest of the board does too, so thank you very much for being with us. I think I could mention the event that the planning New River Valley Regional Commission had.
Yes.
I had never been to the Mercantile, is it just called Mercantile Store?
The Draper Mercantile.
In Pulaski County, but I thought it was, you know, what we do in, or what has been in the past, that some entity or division of what used to be called the Planning District Commission, we would rotate and each one of us would hold a meeting, and usually in the fall. And so this time it was Pulaski who was, you know, it was their turn. And so I kept driving down 81 hoping that I had not passed, you know, that I know my numbers well enough that I'd not passed exit 92. And I hadn't, but nevertheless, it was a very good meeting. It was very different. It was very informal. And there were lots of people there from all over the New River Valley and the entities that are part of what was once the planning district. And so I thought that it was a grand event, and I was glad to see where it was. I've just seen it advertised in the papers. So anyway, I did want to put that we gave the citizen of what? The New River Valley, is that what the title was? To our former chair, Bill Brown, in beginning about March, February, put out feelers for people to nominate people. And so Bill Brown and then Penny Kyle, who's leaving as the president of Radford, they were both sort of shared that honor, but very, very, very deserving. And I was so excited and pleased that Bill Brown was recognized for that. He certainly did a wonderful job for us as chair and was on this board for what, 8 years, Mary? Mm-hmm. Is that what it was? So anyway, it's a good thing. And
don't forget Delegate Yost. Delegate Yost received an award also.
Yeah, Delegate Yost also received a Citizen of the Year award for that event. Then that's about it. And I do want to thank all of you for those that came out to talk to us. I'm glad that two areas, thank you, Joel, for really pursuing the 460 coal bank hollow. You know, there's another coal hollow over there in Christiansburg, so I get a little confused sometimes. But thank you, Joel, for spearheading a lot of that, and then, of course, Full Mode helping us with the Mount Tabor Road. That's enough.
Thank you. A few things. I wanted to commend, and April is the first one I think that brought us to our attention. I had not seen on the Blacksburg's agenda the North Main Interchange. I think I'd received maybe one email, and you brought it to our attention, and just watching at work, and then Annette and Mary getting involved and moving forward, and then our whole board working together. That's been, and seeing the progress and seeing the hope of maybe a permanent solution. That's been outstanding. A few things. in regards to Mary's question and the other questions, I have been in contact with the Water and Power Law Office over in California. We had initially a phone conversation with Marty and Craig and I, and we were all very impressed with the law firm. I felt like they were on the ball. They were addressing the issues that we felt like that we could address. They expressed that they needed to look at possible conflicts. And I did point out that our position has been that we were absolutely opposed to the pipeline, that we did not want to negotiate with alternate routes, and that that was our position. Ms. Scanton indicated that that might be a problem. She sent me an email and said, based on our conversations, I understand that Montgomery County Board of Supervisors has formally adopted a position of complete opposition to the Mountain Valley Pipeline project. I understand this to mean that the county is not interested in engaging FERC, the cooperating agencies, or Mountain Valley Pipeline LLC in discussions of alternative routes or environmental conditions for that pipeline. That position is in conflict with our existing clients. Given that conflict, we unfortunately cannot represent the county. I've done a follow-up email and some follow-up communications to see if we can, if there's a way, and one of the suggestions, I'm not saying that we adopt it, is that we oppose the pipeline, but on some environmental concerns, we raise them and say, look, this wetland needs to be avoided. This piece of karst needs to be avoided. So we would be suggesting a route that would avoid that environmental concern or that historical concern, but still express our opposition. As soon as they get back with me, I will notify the board, but we also are starting to look at additional law firms that might be able to help us if this conflict exists, because I believe some of the things that were pointed out by the citizens that were being raised by Roanoke County are being raised by that law firm, and those are the type of environmental concerns that they're raising. They're saying to FERC that Mountain Valley Pipeline must address this in order for the pipeline to be built. And so it's expressing some opposition, but it's still saying, okay, you need to go around this. You need to address this issue. And so over the next, hopefully we'll know something within the first part of June, if this law firm will be able to represent us. If it's not, we need to explore what other law firms might be out there to help us. Because our county staff, I point out, I know we brought on a few county positions, but we're still down about 30 positions from where we should be. That makes it difficult, and we're leaner than Roanoke County, and they have some additional resources that come with additional employees. And so that's one of the things that we may need to try to address in the future. Other than that, you know, when we just had, and I'm the liaison for the fire and rescue, we just had EMS week, I was able to attend the opening of the Blacksburg Rescue Squad. It is very impressive. It is the type of the thing that we need in our community. When we've got this many volunteers who are providing, I believe it was 255 calls in the month of April that the Blacksburg Rescue Squad responded to. 255 calls in 1 month. That's incredible. So we want to have the facilities where these volunteers can kind of come in and hang out, wait for that next call to come in. Where they can watch Netflix, where they have internet access, where they feel comfortable, and that facility that it addresses those needs. And so I continue to be in awe of our volunteers, and we have one sitting here with us. I was asking him, are you number one as far as responding to calls at the Reiner Fire Department again this year?
Yeah.
And you work full time, you work in the board, and then you spend a lot of time out at that fire department. So that being said, that's all I have, and this meeting is adjourned.